You know, I just felt to speak a message about peace this morning and to really help us walk in consistent levels of peace in our hearts and our lives and you know, removing robbers of peace. This is really more of a pastoral message. But you know, for Christians, really, peace is a person, and that is the person of Jesus Christ and through his Spirit, because Jesus is actually called the Prince of Peace. Isaiah 9. And so really, I'd like to propose to you that there is no true peace outside of Jesus Christ, right there. So that is the bottom line, but let's, learn how to walk out it more. But really knowing him as personal Lord and Savior, that's the big first step to knowing true peace. And sometimes we'll have trouble in this world, but hallelujah that Jesus has overcome the world, because he says this in John 16, 33. These things I've spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. You know, I like to watch, and I recommend this. You can watch 700 Club, their show, on computer, like at any time of day, you just kind of click on the 700 Club show. Phenomenal news, phenomenal stories. But there was a story this week they tell of this man. He was sharing about how he had an abusive childhood, and he was trying to find peace all of his life, you know, filling it with drugs and alcohol, and it was all temporary. And then he got himself into trouble with the law, ended up in jail. And so he's in jail, and there's one guy in jail that's always happy. And he's like, what is with this guy? He's always happy, and we're in jail, for heaven's sakes. So finally, he says to him, like, you know, what's the deal with you? And it turns out, of course, this guy was a Christian. So this guy giving a testimony said about how he accepted Jesus into his life, and he said this peace enveloped his soul, unlike anything he ever thought he could actually have or attain, and how it changed his life. And I thought, you know, it's so simple, but it's so real. Just this search for peace is so prevalent in society, but Jesus is the one. So we're called to pursue peace, all right? It's in the Bible. First of all, Romans 14, 17 says that the kingdom of God, who remembers, is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. So it's like joy and peace really often go together. And so we are to have a determination. You know, it welled up in me years ago. I was just like, I am determined to live a life of peace. And I am determined that my home is going to be a home of peace, that we will have peace in our home. Now, the truth is, I really wasn't raised in a home of peace. There was a lot of non-peace. There was a lot of turmoil. So it was a lesson even to that, the fact that I could live a life of peace. Like, I remember this day. This was many years ago. But I remember the Lord just revealing to me, you know, Patricia, you don't need a problem. You don't always have to have a problem. I'm like, I don't? I know that seems so bizarre, but I just always thought that you went from one problem to another problem, or one issue to another issue. And I just needed to get set free from that mentality of problems, and that we could live perpetual peace. Now, that was revelation. I know for some people, it's a revelation that God is good. You know, that's a revelation, and it's true. So the fact that, you know, we have to make a determination, there's a sense of where it rises up inside of us, says we will have peace. We will have peace, first of all, in my heart. We will have peace. You need to tell your kids that. We will have peace in this house. How many moms and dads agree? We will have peace. We will have peace in this car as we drive down to Florida. Anyway, so I believe in miracles. So Romans 14, 19, therefore let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things by which we may edify another. Number of verses says this, 1 Peter 3:11, let him turn away from good and evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. Say this, pursue peace. All right, so that's in the Bible. We're to pursue peace. Very important. So pursuing peace, of course, it's not to be a state just on dependent on circumstances. You know, there will be circumstances that can make it more peaceful, but it's like there's something about living from the inside out. Living from this perpetual state of peace that doesn't rob us of our joy and peace. You know, it's interesting about jail. Well, it's in Acts 16, where Paul and Silas, here they are in jail. What are they doing in the middle of the night? They're singing songs. Amazing. they're not, you know, ruffled. They're just singing worship. They're worshiping in jail, as was Peter when he was in jail and he was sleeping. Amazing. The angel had to actually strike him to wake him up. So there's something there again about not, and they could have been executed the next day. Talk about peace in the midst of a storm. Well, hearing God, you know, peace is one of the ways that we can hear God. It's an important way we can hear God for direction. If you're asking God, should I do this or should I do that? Well, pay attention to where you have peace. Go deep into your heart. Is there peace here? And for husbands and wives, I really advise that if you're talking big decisions as a couple, what do you both have peace with, right? We've been spared some trouble, John and I, along the way, when one of us did not have peace with a decision. And so we didn't, because both of us were not in peace. And we saw later how, wow, God really saved us in that situation. So pay attention to unity and peace in a marriage. It's one of the ways that God speaks to us. Do you know that sometimes we have to go to war to get peace, right? You know, on our honeymoon, one of our stops in the honeymoon was in Honolulu, Hawaii. And that's where Pearl Harbor, do you remember this, or maybe you don't remember, but December 7th, it was December 7th before 8 a.m., 1941, is when hundreds of Japanese planes came and bombed all the American naval base that was stationed in Pearl Harbor. And most of these sailors were sleeping. It was in the morning and it was Sunday, and they were totally taken by surprise. 2 hours later, there was 20 American naval vessels destroyed, including 8 enormous battleships. One of them is still under the water. You can go see it to today. 300 airplanes were destroyed. 2,000 American soldiers lost their lives, and another 1,000 were wounded. What happened? Well, 2 years prior, war had been going on in Europe. But what happened with this Pearl Harbor bombing is, we know the sleeping giant awoke, didn't it? America awoke. The next day, President Roosevelt, he announces to the world that America is at war with Japan, and they entered the Second World War. Thank God, because really, winning the Second World War was so important, wasn't it, to having peace in Europe, and that we are not under a Nazi regime and under a death camps to those that are less than perfect, or those that are Jewish or whatever. So sometimes you have to go to war to get peace. You know, and that applies even to us, that sometimes we've got to go after the things that rob us of our peace. You know, I was mentioning on Friday night about, and I've probably said this here before, but we have a smaller rear view mirror in our vehicles, a larger windshield, but there are times to look in that rear view mirror and see what's behind. In other words, there's times in our lives to go back to what happened in our lives that may be holding us up. Now, more often than not, we should be looking forward. We got a larger windshield, front windshield, than we do a rear view mirror. But, you know, this reminds me of this story I heard. This guy, he was turning right. He kind of had a short fuse, this guy. And he was turning right to merge onto traffic when the guy behind him honked his horn. Well, this guy just lost it, gets out of his car, goes to the car behind him, and just gives him like his piece of his mind. He was even just, you know, waving his fist. And so this stunned driver is like, ah. And so this guy, and then he's going back to his car, and he looks and sees that bumper sticker that his wife had just put on their car, honk if you love Jesus. This is a true story. That incident pushed the guy into realizing he needed counseling. So he's in a counseling session, and this counselor says, well, we're going to wait on God. It's a good idea. Wait on God, because the Lord knows what is it that is the root to this problem, right? You can try to put a Band-Aid on, but let's go for the root. So I believe in Christian counseling in particular. You know, all forms of counseling are probably good to a degree, but it's like we need to get God into the equation. So anyway, so the Lord, as they're waiting, this guy has this memory, and so the counselor says, well, what were you seeing? He said, forget it. I don't want to share that. It's done. It's over. The counselor says, well, we were asking God, you know, to speak, so you cough it up. What's the memory? Well, the guy finally says, he said, when I was 8 years old, I still sometimes had problems with bedwetting. And there was, my friends were over. I had two friends over. We were drinking lots of Coke and chips or whatever. And so that night, I wet my bed. And I was so embarrassed. You know, I got the sheets together before my friends woke up, put them in the laundry room. But what happened was his mother noticed the sheets in the laundry room, brought them to his father, who decided that today was the day to give a lesson to his son about bedwetting in front of his friends. So this father shamed this guy so badly about wetting the bed at age 8, right in front of his friends. And you know what? What happened was the Lord revealed a root of anger had come in at that time. He was so angry at his dad for doing that. He was so furious, but he was only 8. He couldn't do anything. And so, you know, since then, this root of anger would come up. And so as he repented, you know, for judging his dad, as he forgave his dad from the heart for that incident, he was set free from this short fuse and issue with anger. Hallelujah. Sometimes we need to look back. Yeah, we need to look back in order to go forward. Declare war on the robbers of our peace. Is it unforgiveness? Is there bitterness? Is there willful sin? Is there rebellion? Watching disturbing movies? Is it an atmosphere of turmoil at work or whatever? But it's like, you know, lesser known robber of peace can be this: over-rationalization. Whoa. Anybody do that in the room? Overthink things. Like trying to figure this out and figure that and figure everything out. And why did that person say it to me? And what, by the way, you know, they should have done that differently. And I remember when that happened to me and just thinking. You know what? That's a robber of peace. Sometimes overthinking or over-rationalization can actually be like a mental bombardment and steal from our peace and rob us. Another one, of course, is anxiety. Anxiety is Philippians 4 that says, be anxious for nothing. Nothing, but everything through prayer and supplication. Let their requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. You know, another one I'd like to throw in there is dread. Does anybody dread things? Like, I dread I got to go back to work, or dread that exam that's coming up, or dread fasting. Oh, no. There's more dread on fasting than actually hit it. What are we dreading? Guess what? I don't think we should dread anything. You know, it's like, you know, getting rid of dread. The dread, I got to clean the house. Well, you know, if we just do it and don't let the enemy rob us of peace as we're, you know, looking forward to things and that we need to do or whatever. Do that exam. Students here, you know, doing that assignment. Sometimes there's procrastination that can actually, you know, worsen this whole thing of dread. And I talked about fear from the stage a few months ago, but I was shocked to see that there's actually 540 known and named phobias. Isn't that crazy? 540 known arachnophobia, you know, fear of spiders, and there's fear of holes and fear of whatever. You know, it's just incredible. We had free tickets up the CN Tower. Thank you for whoever gave those to us. And so I sent, all right, Michelle, where's Michelle, my helper? I sent her up not knowing that she had a fear of heights. Well, she went up CN Tower and got healed of fear of heights this week. Hallelujah. Sometimes you have to face your fears. Face the things. Well, let's look at anger. You know, I mentioned this story before, but I think this is a big one, is anger is a robber and all of its minions of frustration and irritation. And, you know, frustration, irritation, impatience. And by the way, it is known, I checked out some studies that peace, if we live a life of peace, by far it increases our life expectancy. Certainly increases our life enjoyment too. But increases life expectancy. Stress is another thing. You know, stress is called one of the biggest killers now, stress. It's just stress on your body and stress that affects your health. Obviously, lack of peace can affect your health. We're going to talk about sleep in a minute. But anyways, this whole thing about anger, and the first biblical reference is Cain. When Cain was angry, you know, because God regarded Abel, his brother's offering, and not his. But this was so interesting because the Lord says, why are you angry? Why is your countenance fallen? If you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and its desire is for you. Whoa. Sin lies at the door and its desire is for you. In other words, even, you know, technically anger is an emotion. Technically anger is an emotion, like fear is an emotion or like joy is an emotion. But a lot of it is what you do with it. Be angry and do not sin, Ephesians 4:26. And don't let the sun go down with your wrath or give place to the devil. Whoa. Don't give place to the devil. Now, not only, you know, is what you do with anger, but it is also if you're, you know, always getting angry, frequently getting anger, then there is a problem. But by the way, there is some righteous anger, isn't there? There's righteous anger. There's righteous anger because Jesus was never, he never sinned, and he had anger when he came into the temple and overturned those tables because they were buying and selling. He said, "My Father's house shall be called a house of prayer." He was angry. And there's certainly enough references to talk about God being angry. So there's a righteous anger that can fuel us into action where we do something. Even Fatine coming here on Friday, I think that's really good because there's been so much happening in politics. I think it should, you know, rise up inside of us to do something, don't you think? It's like, oh God, please not no more bad news. You know, so it's like, come on, let's do something. Let it spurn us to action. But there's this thing of where anger can cause a sin reaction. It lies at the door, its desires for you. Do not let the sun go down. Let's talk about that verse. You know, don't give place to the devil. Many can lose sleep over issues of anger and lack of peace. I don't know how many here in this room that happens to you. It happens to you that you lose sleep at night. You know, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but where it's like things can bug you, or you go to bed at night, you know, having an issue with your spouse or not resolving that, not just about going to bed, but you know, I like this thing about Jesus when he was able to sleep through the storm. Do you remember that? He's sleeping through the storm, and I like this Bill Johnson quote. He says this, "We have authority over any storm we can sleep in." You have to have peace to give it away. Abiding in peace makes us a threat to any storm. Wow, Jesus slept through the storm. Now listen to this. This is another Bill Johnson quote about nighttime. It's in his book, Hosting the Presence. I love this. He says this, "It has been a practice of mine for many years now to go to sleep at night with this simple act. Release my affection for him, for Jesus, until I sense his presence rest upon me. Now, because I'm interested in sleep, I don't use this time to sing praises or even intercede about some great need. I simply love him until my heart is warmed by his presence. If I wake in the night, I resume and turn my heart towards him again, and I go to sleep engaged with him." It's important to know how life works. When God created everything, there was evening, there was morning, one day. This is repeated many times in Genesis chapter 1. The day starts at night. Giving him our nights is the way to start our day. Many would do better in the daytime if they learned to give him their nights. For many, the torment that is experienced in the night watches would end by this simple action. Start your day at night by giving him your affection until he warms your heart, and learn to maintain that sense of presence throughout the night, and it will affect your day. Oh, come on. I love that. If everybody here started practicing that, your head's on the pillow, you haven't quite fallen asleep yet, but if you consciously just say, "Jesus, I love you. I release my affection to you. I release my heart to you. I love you." Turn your attention to him. Let him warm your heart. You know, that's actually where you can start to feel a physical sensation of his presence, of his warmth, and go to sleep that way. Whoa. You wake in the night, do it again. I just love you, Jesus. You know, make him the foremost thing in your mind. It's incredible how you will see the difference, not only in your sleep life, but also in your day life. Come on, I'm talking to somebody here. I feel there's people that have problems sleeping in this place, and God wants to change that. You shouldn't be robbed of 1/8 of your time, which is sleep, and have peace in the night, peace in your sleep that affects your day and everything that you do. Anger can cost you. It can cost you a lot. Moses was the most humble man on the planet. He was amazing. Great leader. he had an incident of where his anger got the best of him. And I think I would have been kind of angry at these guys too, you know? He's like, God, why did you give me this job of leading these million plus people? But what happened was God told him, speak to the rock to release water. And what did Moses do in his anger? He struck the rock twice. He struck the rock. Now, to whom much is given, much is required. And I do think that there's, you know, we keep growing in God and we can come to higher levels of where God is looking for obedience. And now Moses was not obedient. The Bible talks about, God talks to him and says, you didn't honor me. You didn't hallow me in the sight of these people when you struck the rock. What did it cost him? It cost him going into the promised land. Ouch. He died on this side of the promised land. Joshua was the one who took him in. You know, anger's cost many people a lot. It's cost marriages. It's cost relationships with children. It's cost promotions at work. It's cost friendships and certainly peace in your heart. Do you know that many jails are filled with those who never got a hold of their anger issues? They never faced their anger issues, and they did things which landed them in the penitentiary. Proverbs 22:24, make no friendship with an angry man. And with a furious man, do not go, lest you learn his ways and set a snare for your soul. Proverbs 29:22. An angry man stirs up strife, and a furious man abounds with transgression. Whoa. You know, we had this, thank you to Ben and Sarah for organizing this life languages seminar that we had with the staff this week, all day Wednesday. Jenny Sanford, some of you might remember her, but she taught it, and her husband. And it's really good, and I just give you, it's a Christian version of life languages. You know, there'll be different life language things out there, but what this one has the action-orientated language. So we all will speak these languages, or we all will have a propensity to certain ways of relating to people or acting. So the action-orientated languages is the innovative and forceful mover, or the practical and diligent doer. And then there's the emotional languages of the compassionate responder. Most people actually, there's people will have the responder as their main love language. Mine's on the bottom. My goodness, I'm like, I love you, Jesus. And anyway, so I'm like, if you don't think I care, it's because my responder's on the bottom, okay? I do care, but just a little bit. So anyways, sorry. I'm just more of a shaper person. So anyways, there's the intuitive and enthusiastic influencer, the influencer who wants to connect with people. That was actually my second. But anyways, the cognitive or thinking languages, the organized and strategic shaper, the resourceful managing producer, a lot of business people here, you're probably high-level producers, and the intelligent and philosophical contemplators. That's where you see John. That's why he digs deep in the Word. And when you hear a sermon from John, it's always like, what? Where does he get that from? It's because that's the contemplator coming out. All right, but it's very good. None of them are right or wrong. And we speak and operate in all of these languages, but to different degree. But you know, what was interesting is the intensity. The intensity. Do you know, sometimes, like I'm super high intense shaper, for example. And so sometimes, you know, my kids will say to me, Mom, why are you upset? And I'm like, this is not upset. This is just me. this is just me being my usual intense self. And so what happens is sometimes we have to dial down the intensity. Come on, I'm not just talking about, I know this sermon is for me. I realize that. I have not championed all of this, but I like what Joyce Meyer says when she says, I'm not where I used to be. I'm not where I want to be, but I'm okay and I'm on my way. Come on. Who can say that? Not where I used to be. Hallelujah. Not where I want to be, but we're on our way. So we need to dial down that intensity. You know, at times it's like, whoa, we can come across as super, super strong. And so let's look at impatience. Impatience is defined as the inability to accept or tolerate delay, trouble, or suffering without getting angry or upset. And I read that Canada has the least amount of wait time of any nation in the world. How many are happy about that? Okay. But at the same time, then, it means that, you know, when we do wait in line, it's just this thing of patience. I think, by and large, Canadians are pretty patient. But how are you in that? Or how about frustration? It's defined as being upset or annoyed, especially because of inability to change or achieve something. Or irritation, defined as a state of feeling annoyed, impatient, or angry. Whoa. I think these are definitely robbers of peace, irritation, frustration. It's the minions of anger. Come on, church, God wants to heal us. God wants us to live peaceful lives. God wants us to walk in the presence of the Holy Spirit. He is peace. You know, this whole thing of the presence of the Holy, do not quench the Spirit. Do not grieve the Spirit. And He abides in peace. And when we're all in a tizzy and we're all, it's like you can just feel His Spirit lift. Come on, let's live in a perpetual state of the presence of God. The presence of God with us in our marriages and families and at work and when we're driving. Yeah. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger be put away from you. In Proverbs 16, he who is slow to anger is better than the mighty. And he who rules his spirit than he who takes a city. So for some, anger was frequently demonstrated in your home. And it was normal. And a spirit of anger can be generational. You know, there can be this underlying current. There can be this underlying current in people. It's like there's a little bit like a volcano underneath there. And it can erupt at any time. Or have the judged somebody as being angry. Or doing the same things. You see the same traits in yourself that you saw in your mom, your dad, or whoever that you didn't want to be like. You know, like Paul, who said, I do the things I do not want to do. You know what? Again, declaring war on anything that robs us of peace. That God is saying that He wants to set us free. I know this. I know this in my own life. It was a lot of anger demonstrated in the home I grew up in. And I didn't like it in my life. I didn't like, you know, what I saw. And I just want to say, you know, there was layers of healing. But I remember, I may have shared this before, but there was one specific thing. You know, sometimes we have to specifically forgive people for things that we end up doing. For example, I would get upset with my kids when they spilled at the table. Six kids, happened a lot. And I'm just like, oh, why'd you spill your milk again? Why'd you, you know, and get a towel, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, God, I am this godly woman, all right? And why do I still get upset when my kids spill at the table? And the Lord spoke to me, says, it's because your dad got upset with you and you spilled at the table. I'm like, yeah, I forgot that. And so when I specifically forgave my dad, I didn't say anything to him, but I just said, I forgive my dad, Lord. I forgive you, Dad, for when you got upset at me when I spilled at the table. And Lord, forgive me for judging my dad. Because I'm doing the same thing. And when I did that, you know what? Something came off of me. John prayed for me, I know, but something was broke. And then it kept spilling and I didn't get upset. Hallelujah. Like, it's really that simple. But it's where God's saying, you know, declare war. Declare war. Sometimes, come on, church, sometimes you don't see your stuff. Is that revolutionary for you? You know, sometimes you don't see it. That's why you're married, or that's why you're in the body of Christ. And I remember one time I was going down. I was flying, okay, taking time out to fly on my bill down to Hendersonville, North Carolina, to meet with Chester and Betsy Kilstra, the leaders of the RTF, Restoring the Foundations Ministry. And I said to them, I said, you know what? I'm here out of honor and obedience. I don't think there's anything wrong with me. And they're like, okay, thanks for coming out of honor and obedience. They're so patient. God bless them. That was one of the most incredible healing times of my life, seriously. It's because I actually went just because my husband told me to be honest. But I believe it or not, I do submit to my husband. I know that may seem hard to believe, but I do. And so anyways, it was amazing. And can I just share this? This is me being vulnerable. But I had this vision in that time of this little girl in like a basement or like a cellar. And it was dark. And I knew it was this stuck part. I was stuck. When I was a kid, you know, anger and frustration and that stuck part. I remember this vision, this little kid. And it was like there was a little me inside of me that was dominating parts of my life. And we're, you know, asking God to come, asking God to forgive, asking God to reintegrate that part, heal it. I remember clearly Jesus, his vision was so powerful. He opened the door, light flooded in. That girl, you know, grew up or whatever, became part of me, and things changed from that time. And I was so glad I flew down to get inner healing. And this is a plug for inner healing. Do you know sometimes you're coming against stuff that you just feel like, why do I keep banging my head against this wall? Or what is it? Is there a demonic thing? Is there a spirit of anger? Or is there a spirit that's robbing your peace? Declare war on anything that robs you of peace. Hallelujah. You know, and by the way, you're never too old to see change and to see transformation. And this is just, you know, the ABCs of salvation are this. A, admit you're a sinner. B, believe Christ paid the price for your sins when he died on the cross. C, confess and repent your sins. The ABCs of getting free of a stronghold are similar. A, admit you got a problem. Admit it. Admit it. Face it. You know, sometimes that's what people are there to speak into our lives. Believe Jesus paid the price on the cross to set you free from that. And see, confess it to the Lord and to others. And turn away from that sin. Turn away from that addiction. Or turn away to freedom in Christ. Come on. It is absolutely possible. Don't believe the lie that you're going to stay this way or this is your lot in life or whatever. You are inexcusable, old man, Romans 2 talks about, and who you judge, whatever you judge, that you condemn yourself, because there's power when we judge people. You know, I really believe that the blame game, you know, needs to stop. Oh, if these kids would straighten up, if my spouse, if my boss would get fired, wouldn't that be awesome? You know, if my coworker would just straighten, you know what? You can't change any of them. You can change you. You can change your reaction. How you respond to that situation, that's what can change. And you know, this is interesting because here's some don'ts. Don't do things while angry. Come on, parents, don't discipline in anger. Don't send an email in anger. Somebody needed to hear that. Don't make a phone call in anger. Okay, do this. When out of peace or tempted to do or say something, come on, that would get you in trouble, step away, pray, ask the Holy Spirit to fill you. Seriously. Ask the Holy Spirit, what do you say? Give me wisdom. Even if it's a quick moment, step away for a moment. Just pray. Ask the Holy Spirit to fill you. Ask the Holy Spirit to lead you. Ask him for peace. Ask him for his presence and his guidance. You will not make a mistake if you do that. It's so simple, but it's so true. Don't react. Step away and pray. Come on, talk. It saves you all kinds of trouble. I'll save you trouble in work. I'll save you trouble in your marriage. Proverbs 17:27. He who has knowledge spares his word, and a man of understanding is of a calm spirit. For a fool is counted wise when he holds his peace, and when he shuts his lips, he's considered perceptive. There you go. Shut up, all right? There. It's a word of the Lord. Stay in peace at all times. So peace is a weapon. Peace is a place of where, you know, we receive our inheritance. Peace is powerful. I remember when, you know, I found out that had some issues with one of our children because of an immunization. My entire prayer life was taken up with that. I was so distraught. God, why? Why? Oh, God, what are you doing? God, why? Lord. And I've shared the story here before, but I remember being right here in the front row. And I am in this, it was Sunday morning, I'm in this vision, and it was all about my daughter. And I'm in this vision of being in the boat with the disciples when the storm had hit for me. And I'm literally in this vision, I feel like I'm going to throw up because I'm like seasick. This is so powerful. Remember Carol Arnett coming over to me, and she said, what is going on with you? I said, this is weird, but I know it's all about this, it's, you know, the immunization thing. And I'm just, I'm in this boat with the disciples. And she's like, well, peace be still. And something lifted off of me. I'll never forget that. And it was after that time the Lord said, you know what? Will you love me anyway? Will you pray for the sick anyway? Will you serve me anyway? And I'm like, God, till my last breath, I will love you and serve you. Even though I don't understand why I have this in my family. Come on, church. The enemy just wants to derail. Let's all stand. Worship team, can you guys come back up? We have authority over any storm we can sleep in. Romans 15, 13. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we love you. Thank you, God, for an inheritance of peace. Thank you for your presence here. Thank you for transformation. Hope. Come and transform us. You know, first of all, I want to speak to those. Just close your eyes for a minute. Just stay just in the place of your presence, if you can. Just stay there. You know, those of you who you know you need to have that place of peace in your heart, first of all, by giving Jesus lordship of your life. That's the first step. The Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, he can come and inhabit our very lives through the Holy Spirit when we say yes to him. So the wages of sin is death, or the price of our sin, the things we do wrong, it's death. The price of that is death. And see, our sin separates us from this holy God, perfect God. Jesus paid a price of death. He came to earth, sinless, spotless Lamb of God. Why? So he could die on a cruel cross to take the penalty of our sin upon himself. It's really amazing. Good deal. Really good deal. So we exchange, by saying yes to Jesus, we exchange our sin for righteousness. We can exchange poverty for riches. We can exchange lack of peace for peace. For his presence, for his lordship, leadership. Oh. Sometimes we need to rededicate. I had to rededicate my life to Jesus. Jesus, break in. Touch every heart and life here. Come and speak. Listen to that nudge. Listen to that whisper. Obey that nudge. The Holy Spirit on your heart today saying it's time, it's time. It's time. It's time to surrender. It's time for me to take up total habitation of your life, to lead you, guide you. It's time for you to surrender. It's time for you to surrender that will, that strong will that has wrestled against God, that has wrestled against his leadership. Ho, Shika, come Holy Spirit, breathe your life. Breathe. There's a nudging going on right now. The Holy Spirit is speaking to hearts and lives. Come and surrender. Where are you in this room? I want you to run down here. Listen to that. You need to say yes to Jesus. You need to give him everything, your heart, your mouth, your life, your very being, to surrender to this Prince of Peace. Oh, I encourage you to come. Listen to that whisper. Listen to that nudge. Oh. Don't worry about who's watching you. It's you and God. And maybe somebody can come with you. Maybe if you just say, hey, will you come with me? And let's go together. Will you walk down with me? Yeah, just come wherever you are. Just let's say yes to him. First of all, let's say yes to his lordship. Hey, yes to that breakthrough of the heart, first and foremost. Break in, Holy Spirit. Listen to that whisper. We're going to have another prayer in just a minute, but I know there's God is speaking to the hearts of people here today. Surrender to my lordship. Surrender everything. Huh. Everything. Everything. There's a, yeah, break in. Break in. Fire. Come on. Whoa. Fire of God. Break in, Holy Spirit. Break in, Holy Spirit. Break in, Holy Spirit. Come. Say yes, say yes, say yes, say yes. Say yes, say yes, say yes to you. Say yes, say yes. Come on, we say yes to you, Jesus. Solely. Pour out. Pour out, Prince of Peace. There's an appointment. You got an appointment with the Prince of Peace. Get an appointment with the Prince of Peace this morning. Those of you responding to this call, I want you to come over here. Those of you just wanting general peace, you can stay there. But if you need to surrender your life, those of you who need to... Hey. Oh, Jesus. Could we just have some more ministry team come out up here? Any of you that are cell leaders, ministry team, come on, this is awesome. Break in, Holy Spirit. Say this with me, these ones up here, say this. Everybody in the room, Jesus, I say yes to your lordship, to your leadership, to your will, to your way. Forgive me all sin, all of it. Forgive me, wash me, help me to really know you. Prince of Peace, come. Inhabit my life. Inhabit my very being. Prince of Peace, come. Holy Spirit, come and fill them right now. I ask for the fire of your Spirit. Break in, break in, break in. Power of the Spirit. Break into every heart here, every life here. Thank you, Jesus. You brought them here for this appointment with you to know you. To know you. Fire. Fire, power. Power, power encounter. Power encounter. Break in, Holy Spirit. Break in, power encounter. Change to never be the same again. Break in, break in. Fire of God. Hey! Hey! Shut out. Break in, Holy Spirit. Break in the power of your Spirit. The power of your Spirit. Fire. Holy Spirit, come. We love you. We honor you. Shiara, fire. For all of these ones, precious ones that responded to this call, don't leave without coming into the side room over here and getting some material and having some more prayer. You can go there now or you can just go in a minute because I know the Holy Spirit is working on you, but don't leave until you get some materials from our team. And I want to open this up. Come on, church. Let's just get real today. There's people here today, you need freedom from a lack of peace. You need a breakthrough in peace. I want you to run to the altar and just kneel before Him. Whether it's anger, whether it's frustration, irritation, whether it's that there's trouble sleeping at night, whether it's that over-rationalization thing or anxiety or whatever it is, God is gonna set us free. I believe this. I believe the Lord gave me a word this morning or this week that He was gonna bring breakthrough in peace, that we were to take authority over anger and specifically, but there was going to be a breakthrough in peace. This is our inheritance. This is our right. Where there has been a lack of peace, we're just saying today, the line is in the sand. No more. No more. I'm going to be changed by the glory of God. And for some, pursue that healing or that deeper inner healing. We have inner healing ministers in this church, but don't go through life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah that God has done a work in my life. I don't want to go through life robbed of peace. Come, Holy Spirit, just make your way forward. Make your way just before the Lord. It's you and God. It's you and God. Even if you want to kneel before Him, release any of the prayer team, ministry team. In the name of Jesus, we take authority through the power of the blood of Jesus over every robber of peace. In Jesus' name, lift, 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 lift. Anger, anger, you go. Just begin to confess it to the Lord. Lord, I confess this. Anger goes off. You know what? I feel like there's some sin things that are coming up. People, you know who you are. There's pornography stuff, pornography issues. That's what's robbing your peace. Your peace is being robbed by what's going through your eye gates, what's going through your ear gates. In the name of Jesus, God, break the addiction. Break the strongholds. Come in your glory this morning. Come in your power and presence. Lift off anxiety. Lift off over-rationalization, overthinking. Lift off every robber of peace. In Jesus' name, you go, fire of God, flow, 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 flow. Break in, Holy Spirit. Break in, Holy Spirit. Break in, Holy Spirit. Break in, Holy Spirit. Any of our cell group leaders and team or staff or interns, come on up here and just begin to pray for people. Break through, break through, break through, break through, break through, break through. Freedom, freedom. I even see some are getting deliverance this morning. Deliverance. You demonic thing, come up and out in Jesus' name. Every root that our Heavenly Father has not planted, come up and out in Jesus' name. Freedom, 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 freedom in the mind, freedom, freedom over sleep. Peace in the night watches, peace in the night seasons, peace. Fire of God flow. Breakthrough, breakthrough.